إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له جل على المثيل والنظير، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اقتفى أثره واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أيها المسلمون عباد الله، from the critical moments in the history of Islam where if Allah Azza wa Jalla hadn't ordained what He ordained, this ummah would have never been established, was the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Towards the end of his life, people started accepting Islam in their hundreds, in their thousands, in their tens of thousands, and tribes would enter Islam until Islam spread all over the Arabian Peninsula. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had an enemy, or the next enemy in mind in his advance was the Byzantine Empire, the Romans of that day, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had prepared for them an army. This army, he appointed a young man not older than 18 years old, Usama ibn Zayd ibn Harith. Usama ibn Zayd was young man, this young companion, may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with him and his father, had lost his father as a martyr in Mu'tah, and his father was the son that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taken in, and for a while he was known as Zayd ibn Muhammad, until Allah Azza wa Jalla told us about the laws of adoption in Islam. This man, or this young man, 18 years old, his army had some of the more senior companions, Umar ibn Khattab and the rest of these companions. But as this army was prepared, and as it was the customs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was the commander in chief, he would have to tie the flag of this army. He would have to tie the flag on the pole so that this army is officially set and ready to go. After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did so, he fell sick, and this army actually remained behind in Medina just to see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sickness would result in. They didn't want to depart Medina and leave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a poor physical state, so they remained behind, and some of the historians report that this army remained in its shields and it remained in the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the upcoming days. As these days went by, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sickness became more serious, and we mentioned last week Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu stayed with him and remained with him all of his days. And as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu remained with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, frequenting him at all of the prayers, he sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't able to attend and told the people, "Muru Aba Bakrin falyusalli bin nas." Command Abu Bakr, let him lead the prayer and lead the people in prayer. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq did so, and on the Monday, the 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal, on the 11th year of Al-Hijrah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out at Salat al-Fajr and looked at his companions. He saw amongst them the young companions, the likes of Usama ibn Zayd. He saw amongst them the people that were willing to give up their time, their wealth, their lives for this religion. And he knew that this religion of Allah Azza wa Jal is in a good place. And he smiled, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he went back and he felt a bit better and he felt a bit energized. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq left and he went to a place that he had in the outskirts of Medina. As he was there, he received the news that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had passed away. He came back to find Umar ibn Khattab between the people, telling them, anyone that says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had passed away will get a taste of this medicine, this sword that he was holding. And he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hasn't passed away, but he only departed to his Lord, like Musa went to his Lord for 40 days and he will return. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq walked into the house of the Prophet, and he walked into the house of his daughter Aisha radiallahu anha. He found the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam laying there, his face covered. He uncovered his face, he kissed his forehead, and he'd known that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has passed away. He came out to the people, he stood on the minbar, he told Umar ibn al-Khattab to lower his weapon. He came out to the people and he said that whoever worships Muhammad, then verily Muhammad had passed away. وَمَنْ كَانَ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيُّ لَا يَمُوتُ. And whoever worships Allah Azza wa Jal, then verily Allah Azza wa Jal is eternal and he will never pass away. This reaffirming the first article of faith, that we bear witness that Allah Azza wa Jal, we bear witness and we testify that Allah Azza wa Jal is alone, the eternal worthy of worship, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, with all of the rights that Allah Azza wa Jal gave him, with the status that he was given by Allah, was nothing but a slave and a messenger. And then he recited the ayat, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was no one but a messenger, and before him messengers had come. And he recited the ayah, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. Verily you will pass away, O Muhammad, and they will pass away. And the destiny of Allah Azza wa Jal had befallen his Prophet. And this is a reminder for people that live today, 1400 years after the incident, and still hold on to the fact and can't accept the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was a human being, and that his time was done, his message was fulfilled. He delivered what the Prophet or Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded from him, and Allah Azza wa Jalla has taken it back. And this was accepted by a man that loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam more than all of us collectively, by Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He was firm and strong, and he accepted it at a place that others thought it was difficult to accept. But the level of iman that he had, he accepted that. Not only did he accept it, he was able to convey it to the people. And Umar ibn Khattab said that, I fell to my knees, and it was as if the first time I heard the ayah. But it wasn't the first time. And then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq took the affairs of Muslims. The first thing that needed addressing was who's going to run this city. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was there for 10 years. Before it were these two tribes of Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj that we know and we've spoken about before, that these two tribes that became Al-Ansar, they had met in a place known as the Saqifah, and they'd agreed amongst themselves that this man, Sa'd ibn Ubad radiallahu anhu, was going to become their leader. And Umar ibn Khattab, once he heard this, he went with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq to the Ansar, and he gathered some of the Muhajireen, some of the companions with them that had actually migrated from Mecca, and went. And it was reported to Umar ibn Khattab and Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah were with Abu Bakr, and they went and they spoke to the Ansar. They addressed them, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq spoke. And Umar ibn Khattab narrates this hadith in Bukhari, and he says that, I had prepared a speech that I wanted to address the people with. But he said, once Abu Bakr as-Siddiq spoke, he'd mentioned everything I wanted, and he added to it. And he mentioned the favors that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam named and told us that the Ansar have. That he said that there are no people that were more supportive to me than the Ansar. And he said, if people were to seek a way, if people were to take and thread a path, and the Ansar were to thread another path, I will go with the Ansar. And he mentioned these favors. And then he told them, do you not acknowledge that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one that said this? They said, yes, we do. He said, do you not acknowledge that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one that said that the leader or the commander is from the Muhajirun, and the advisors are from the Ansar? And they acknowledged. And at that moment, Umar ibn Khattab told him to extend his hand, and he appointed him, or he gave him the bay'ah, the covenant that he is the Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah did. Then the Ansar that were there did, and they nominated him as the appointed Khalifa. And the next day, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu took the bay'ah from the general Muslims. And the cloud of doom that was there in Medina, that Anas ibn Malik narrates, he said there wasn't a day that the sun of Medina shone or was shining better than the day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Medina. And he said there wasn't a day that it was darker and greyer and gloomer in Medina than the day of the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was buried. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq rose to the affairs of the Ummah, and the first command he had was to fulfill the army of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The people around him, they told him, they said, oh Abu Bakr, How are you going to send an army now? The circumstance doesn't allow for it. Some people are withholding their zakah. Some of the Arabs that repented or turned to Islam and embraced Islam towards the end of the Prophet ﷺ's life started leaving Islam. There were people that were rising around the Arabian Peninsula, such as Musaylam al-Kadhab and Aswad al-Ansi and the rest of these that claimed, or al-Absi, that claimed that they were prophets and messengers after the Prophet ﷺ. So they told him this wasn't a time to send an army. But Abu Bakr as-Siddiq's status, he said that I would not untie a flag that the Prophet ﷺ tied. This army was prepared by the Prophet ﷺ and this army will march on. And the army went. And it went and it approached and it was a reconnaissance. There was no battle that took place. They came back. But at that time, the Arabian Peninsula, the people that had crossed their mind to attack Medina and they thought that this was a time of weakness, they thought and they reflected and they said, these are people that they just lost their prophet. They just lost their leader. But they have the time to send an army to not only small Arabian tribes, they are sending it to one of the two superpowers of the world at that time. These are not people that are in a position of weakness. And any tribe that had intention of attacking Medina remained behind and stood back and refused to engage in this time and this battle. So after this army came back, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu engaged in Hurub al-Riddah. 40 battles that took place, and he had prepared 13 different armies or small armies that they went and fought and tackled the different armies of different people that had turned away from the religion of the Prophet ﷺ. And there were three groups. One group were people, the Arabs, that accepted Islam out of position of weakness at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. They'd seen that the power, the might, the power in the superpower in the Arabian Peninsula was the Prophet and his companions, so they accepted Islam. And after this, the Prophet ﷺ's death, they decided that there's no more power for us here, so we need to turn away from this religion. And they turned away from the religion. And Abu Bakr Siddiq attacked them and sent armies to attack them. Either they are going to fall back in line, or they are going to be expelled and migrated. The second type of people that he fought with were people that claimed prophet. And this is one of the wisdoms of Allah Azza wa Jal, that he appointed the most beloved person to the Prophet ﷺ after him. And we know the Prophet ﷺ said, if I was going to take a Khalid, a companion, it would be Abu Bakr. And the Prophet ﷺ said about Umar, he said that if there was going to be a prophet after me, it would be Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. And if these two people do not claim prophethood, no one else can claim prophet. No one else. But there were people that thought it was a moment to seize power, to seize status. They had seen what the Prophet ﷺ amassed and congregated in terms of wealth, power, numbers and people. So they wanted some of that position and they claimed prophet. And one of the most famous battles was the Battle of Al-Yamama with Musaylam al-Kadhab, where he sent some of the companions and many, many of the companions were killed. But these people were defeated and they'd taken back this land to the Muslims, and a lot of these people repented and their repentance was accepted and documented. And at that time, many of the people that memorized the Quran and parts of the Quran were killed. So after this battle, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anh consulted Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anh had the idea to compile the Quran and to write the Quran and whatever is in the Quran into one book. Because up until that moment, Medina didn't have many people that not memorized the Quran. It was from them Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anh, from them Ubay ibn Ka'b, from them Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and others, but there were few in numbers that memorized the Quran. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anh didn't memorize the Quran, he memorized parts of it. Umar ibn Khattab didn't memorize the Quran, or at least that's what's reported to us, is that they didn't memorize the Quran, they memorized parts of it. And other companions, they had been there with the Prophet ﷺ when parts were mentioned and they memorized that. They had written parts of it into their own little notes and collections on rock, on leather of animals, on whatever they could find to write. Because paper wasn't something that was there and common and people could write on it. So all of these different parts of the Quran were kept with different people. And Zayd ibn Thabit was called by Umar ibn Khattab and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and he was told that your role is to collect all of the verses of the Quran and to write them and organize them as you'd heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it was reported that Zayd ibn Thabit was the companion that was the companion that was sat with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the 10th year in Ramadan, when Jibreel came down and recited the Quran twice with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is reported that this is the companion that had known, not only was he close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and was one of his scribes, he was a young man with good memory, and he sat with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when the Quran was mentioned and the Quran was recited. So he came and he started collecting the different parts of the Quran, and up until today we owe these companions, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and Umar bin Khattab and the rest of these companions, for their efforts, not only in collecting the Quran, but making sure that this religion stays firm. Making sure that after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this religion reaches. Making sure that they protected the city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they protected Mecca. And this is something that we will never pay them, or will never repay them. However, one thing that we can do is know about them, understand their lives, understand their stories, and pass this on to our next generations. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله واستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله على إحسانه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له تعظيما لشأنه، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه. أما بعد. Now mentioning two or three lessons that could be taken from the life of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq رضي الله عنه. And the lessons are many. The lessons are many. And it's important for every Muslim to know and look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq رضي الله عنه when it comes to wanting to implement the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because many people, and it comes prominent at certain times of the year when we deal with next month, when we start dealing with the matter of Rabi' al-Awwal and celebrating the Mawlid of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. People that say they love and claim to love the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and these celebrations come from a place of love. We tell them, look at Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. What did he do? Was this his sunnah? Because we know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي, follow my sunnah and the sunnah of the Khulafa al-Rashideen after me, the four guided Khalifas after me. Was this how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam followed? Was this how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was followed by these companions? No. What's the example of these companions? What did they do? Do you have, or are you competing, or are you following, emulating the life of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq when it comes to salah, when it comes to zakah, when it comes to sadaqah, when it comes to extra nawafil, when it comes to Quran, when it comes to night prayer? Or is the extent of our love for them naming some of our kids after them? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was a man that had a level of competition that he could only compete with himself. He'd set a standard for himself, and he continued to compete against it. He came at the Battle of Tabuk, and the Jaysh al-Usra that Allah told us, an army of difficulty, bringing all of his wealth. While some of the other companions were thinking, today I beat Abu Bakr, today I will outdo Abu Bakr. He was outdoing himself. Whatever he can, whatever he has given previously, was nothing in comparison to what he was going to give. He'd left for them Allah and his messenger. He's a man that we see from the start of the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam believed in him and continued to believe in him. And when people ridiculed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the journey of Isra and Mi'raj, he said that I believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in matters that are far greater than ascending and descending. He said I believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that which is revealed to him in the Quran. And he didn't believe in the Qur'an by just saying, I believe in it. By acting upon it. By implementing what's in the Qur'an. By following what's in the Qur'an. So much so that after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he fought people that had withheld the zakah. And he said, Wallahi, if they hold one dinar that they used to give the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I'll fight them for it. This wasn't a man that missed salahs. This wasn't a man that missed zakah. This wasn't a man that took lightly any of the commandments of Allah azza wa jalla. This is a man that we should follow him. We should know about him. We should understand about his life. We should know why Allah Azza wa Jalla gave him this lofty status. And his love for the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is one of the reasons. That love that he had, the truest form of love, we've mentioned over this khutbah and last khutbah how much he was willing to sacrifice and give for the Prophet ﷺ. Yet he didn't lead him to ghulu. He didn't lead him to misguidance. The story of Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, there was never a chance that two khutbahs or two 20-minute speeches were going to do it justice. But this is a snapshot into the life of the greatest companion, the best of friends to the Prophet ﷺ, a man that Allah Azza wa Jalla affirmed that friendship and that companionship, a man that the Prophet ﷺ guaranteed in Jannah, a man that the Prophet ﷺ told us that he was the most beloved person to him, a man that the Prophet ﷺ told us, he said that anyone that had owed us anything would repay them back, he said, except Abu Bakr. He has favors upon us that only Allah Azza wa Jalla would be able to repay. This great companion, this great man, passed away 2 years after the Prophet ﷺ's life. But he laid the groundwork and the foundation for all of the khulafa that came after him. We're going to speak about Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu after. But there's never going to be a chance that any of the work that Umar ibn Khattab did was able to be carried out except for the groundwork that was laid by Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And that's why after his death, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu looked and he said, أَتْعَبْتَ الْخُلَفَاءَ بَعْدَكَ يَا أَبَا بَكَرَ. You've made it difficult for any of the successors that come after you, any of the rulers that come after you, Abu Bakr, you've made it difficult for them. And this man, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, as we mentioned, his name, Abdullah ibn Uthman ibn Amir ibn Amr al-Taymi al-Qurashi, is a name that we should know, is a story that we should learn, and alhamdulillah, it's been written, it's been documented, it's there in audio recordings, it's there on YouTube, and there's no excuse for any Muslim to not know about this companion. The only excuse is lack of effort, and ask Allah to free us from that lack of effort and allow us to learn about the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, allow us to follow the example, allow us to take them as they truly are, truly guided companions that Allah chose as companions for His Prophet. And ask Allah to allow us to be reunited with them and the Prophet ﷺ in the highest ranks of Jannah. هذا والله أعلى وأعلم بالنسبة العلم إلي أسلم أيها المسلمون إن الله أمركم بأمر بدأ فيه بنفسه وثنى بملائكة وثلث بكم أيها المسلمون فقال إن الله وملائكة يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على خير خلق محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وأقم الصلاة.